All right, so there's a bunch of ways you could imagine doing this, and here's how I would suggest looking at it. So for each of these 28 positions, there's some number of steps that it's going to take before it either resets, that is to say, you know, re-chooses at random, or has actually reached the tippy top. So let's actually evaluate these. So if you happen to start at one, how many steps is it before you realize that you're at one? You have to evaluate one, you have to evaluate two, you have to evaluate three, and you have to evaluate four to see that you're a local optimum.
Mm-hmm.
So there's going to be four evaluations if you start at one. If you start at two, then it's going to be one. You're going to have to evaluate one, two, three, and four again. If you start at three, then you only need to evaluate two, three, and four to know that you're at a local optimum.
Mm-hmm.
If you start at four, then you'll have to evaluate four. And then if you randomly step in this direction, you're also going to need to evaluate two, and three. All right, so then I finished writing down what all these different numbers are. For each position here, I wrote down in red how many steps it's going to take before it hits a local optimum, including the ones here around the actual peak. And I wrote two numbers for the places that were these cusps where it can go either way. So now we can actually work out what the expected number of steps to the global optimum is. It turns out for 22 out of 28 of these points, they average 5.39 before they discover they're actually at a local optimum, at which point we have to start the whole process over again. And so whatever the expected value of reaching the local optimum is, we incur that same cost again.
That makes sense.
Good. Okay. So for 4 out of 28, these guys here, then they're going to take 4 steps on average and end up at the peak. Then the only other things that left to figure out are what happens at these two weird cusps where just to flip, it's going to flip a coin and either get stuck at a local optimum that's not global or go to the global optimum. So in 2 out of 56 of these cases, it's going to have chosen to go to the local optimum, the non-global local optimum. And it just so turns out that it's 10 in both of those cases. It's 10 steps before you realize you're stuck again, at which point it's going to start the whole process over again because it's stuck. Then in 156 of the cases, we're going to be here and choose to go to the right and take 6 steps to get to the global. And here, 156 of the cases, we're going to take 5 steps and get to the global.
Okay, so just to be clear, so the way you got 28 is that there were 28 numbers and you uniformly chose where to start.
Yep.
Where you got 56 is you decided that for two of those numbers, 15 and 20, you end up getting them 1/28 of the time, and then half the time you do the local optimum and half the time you end up doing the global optimum. And it just turns out that in the cases where you end up going to the local optimum, those both happen to take 10 steps, and that's how you got 2 out of 56. And the last thing to notice is that for point number 4, where you could go to the left or to the right, since you do each half the time, it's like saying the number of steps there is just 11 over 2.
On average, yeah, very good. Yeah, so that was folded into this 5.39 number. You're right. Thanks for pointing that out.
Okay, sure. So this all makes sense. And obviously, if you just add those all up, you can solve for V, and the answer is exactly.
So just algebraically simplifying this equation gives us V equals 5.36 plus 0.82V. Solving for V gets us 29.78. So it only takes 29.78 function evaluations before we first hit the maximum. Ta-da.
Michael?
Yes, sir.
So that seems unfortunate. Because here's a really simple algorithm. For I equals, or hey, let's say X. For X equals 1 to 28, compute F of X. If it's bigger than my previous one, then hold on to it, and then just return whatever's the biggest number I see. So that's linear, and that's 28 evaluations, which is less than 29.78.
Yeah, that's a good algorithm in this case. But I guess your point is that this whole idea of hill climbing and using this local information is actually costing us a little bit compared to just enumerating all the possible inputs and just testing them all.
Right. Which I guess makes sense because the numbers are really small and you have a whole bunch of local optima. And so it's going to take you a long time to luck into the right one. But it seems kind of sad that there's nothing clever you can do here to do better than 28, which is kind of what you want to do.
Well, there's a couple clever things we could do, right? So one is we could random restart faster. It turns out, imagine, no. So here's a question. What happens if you randomly restart after each function evaluation? How many function evaluations do we have to do on average before we reach the maximum?
I don't know. Oh, well, I guess it would be less than 28.
It would be exactly 28.
Oh, it would? Well, yeah. 28 is less than 28, so that's fair.
It's less than or equal to it, sure.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
And even better, what happens if we actually keep track of points that we visited in the past?
Oh, then we don't pay the cost for reevaluating them.
That's right.
So then the only question is, how long does it take us to luck up into getting between 15 and 20?
Yes. Well, once we fall into that zone, then we're going to be done shortly afterwards.
Right. So how much of a win is that on average?
That's a good question. It's a little bit hard to tell, because what's going to happen is, if we follow this algorithm with the additional thing, additional attribute that says, if you already know the function evaluation from some previous iteration, we just reuse it. We don't pay the cost for that. Then what's going to happen is, we're going to get dropped off in random places in this space. We're going to hill climb, visiting some things along the way, and possibly get dropped someplace where we've already done the function evaluation.
Right.
And therefore, don't have to pay that cost again. But it's not as simple as just saying, how many different hops do we take before we land in this basin? Because if we land in, say, this basin here, the second one from the left, if we, you know, get dropped onto point 14, it's going to stay in that zone for a while, which is actually kind of bad, because it's taking lots of function evaluations in that same part of the space.
But what you just said is important, right? Since we're only going to pay the cost of doing a function evaluation once, that means in the worst case, we would end up hitting the three bad basins before we hit the fourth basin. And in fact, we would end up hitting the three bad basins enough times that we would end up visiting all of the points in them. So we'd land in point 14, which would get us all the way over to the peak and just to the left, and then we would land in 5.5, which would get us to the right. So we cover everything in the basin. So the worst case is, we cover every single point in all three of those basins before we get lucky enough to land in the good basin.
Right.
And then, but the moment we land in the good basin, we will get to, am I right? We will get to avoid at least one of those numbers.
No, not necessarily. So, for example, if we start at 15 and we randomly move to the right, to know that we're at the optimum here, we have to check the point 19. So we've actually touched everything.
No, we didn't touch 20.
Well, we might have already unluckily hit 20, because it's part of the right-hand basin as well.
That's
well,
true.
Anyway, the point is that you're right. If we keep track of which points we've already visited, then we can't do worse than 28. Like, even if we're really, really unlucky, we can't do worse than 28.
Right.
Maybe on average it'll be a little bit better than that. But only one or two.
But it'll still be better.
I think it'll still be better.
On average,
yeah,
it'll be
better. Yeah, it's true. I think in this case, it's just a contrived example with lots of local optima and just a linear space, so that there's the attraction basins end up being relatively small compared to the size of the space.
Hmm. Okay, that makes sense. So what should I learn from this? So I guess what I learned is randomized optimization, or randomized hill climbing here, may not do better than evaluating all the space in the worst case, but it won't do any worse. And every once in a while, you will get lucky and do much better, at least if your cost is function evaluations as opposed to steps.
That's right. Yeah. And also, well, and the thing that I was hoping that you'd notice is this idea that randomized hill climbing depends a lot on the size of the attraction basin around the global optimum. So if we make that really big, then this is a huge win. If we make it really small, then it's less of a win.
No, and that makes a lot of sense. Right. So if the third one had gone all the way from, say, number 3 to number 26, then you would fall into it immediately, and you'd get there very quickly.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, I see that. That makes a lot of sense. So when you asked me before what the advantages are, you know, you're in a place where the attraction basin for your global optima are in fact relatively big. If you can, once you luck into that part of the space, and there's lots of ways to luck into that part of the space, you can get there very quickly. So it's a big win.
Agreed.
Okay. Good. Okay. That makes sense to me. I like that.